Okay, thank you, Matteo, and good morning, everybody. Let me introduce Dr. Christian Durier, and he received the engineering degree from the Institut Catholique d'Art Métier at Lille, and the PhD degree in robotics from the University of Évry in France. His thesis work was realized at the Robotics and Interactive System Technologies, followed by a postdoctoral position at the CIMIT SIM Group in Boston. He arrived at INRIA in 2006 to work on interactive simulation of deformable objects, optic rendering, and medical simulation. Now he is the head of the DeFrost team, created in January 2015. And his research topic are soft robot models and control, fast finite element methods, simulation of contact response, and other complex mechanical interaction. All his research results are developed in SOFA, which is a framework that they co-develop with other INRIA teams. He was also one of the founders of the startup company Insimo, which used their research results for a fantastic humanitarian project that is Help Me See. And now he recently got the prize, Ernest Deschel, from the French Academy of Science in Applied Mathematics. Today, his talk is on the DeFrost platform, modeling, simulation, and control of deformable robots on SOFA framework. So I leave the floor to Dr. Durier, and if you want, you can share your screen. And
so thank you very much for this nice presentation, Francesca. I've asked my colleague Hugo Talbot, who is the head of the consortium SOFA, to present SOFA, as this session is a tutorial, and this tutorial is mainly based on SOFA. I thought it was nice to have an introduction of what is this framework and what is the role of the consortium. So I think Hugo will present. We'll start this part of the presentation.
Yeah, thank you, Christian. Good morning, everyone. So as Christian just said, I'm gonna present you what is SOFA, and then we're gonna pursue, you know, with the tutorial that Christian just mentioned, which is based on SOFA. But you will see that it's not only SOFA; it's all the soft robotics technologies developed in the DeFrost team. So my name is Hugo Talbot. I hope you can see properly my slides. I hear you can also hear my voice properly. Let me know if there is an issue. And so I just put my email here in case you have any questions about SOFA later on. So I'm going to talk about SOFA, which is an open source simulation for collaboration in simulation in general. SOFA is an open source project, which actually started back in 2006. So as you can see, it's not that young. It's quite an old project now, where we have been investigating many different topics and domains in simulation. It arose really from the need of several research teams. At the beginning, they were only French, but thankfully there have been other guys than only French guys joining the community. And the initial need was really to share a common platform for simulations. And starting from the very beginning, the purpose was to become an open source reference, useful for many purposes, for interactive and real-time application. What you will find in SOFA, when you just download SOFA, without all the soft robotics plugins that we are gonna talk about today, what you will find mostly, it's models and algorithms that are dedicated to soft and rigid body dynamics. So it means we are not only modeling and simulating robots or, you know, silicone shapes that will deform, but you can also model any kind of object, rigid or deformable, and their interaction together. That's all the purpose of SOFA, to be basically what is called the physics engine and to handle interactions between virtual objects. That's what does SOFA. And I told you it started back in 2006. So for all those years of developments, so 15 years of developments, we have been investigating actually many different application fields. First, the very first one, original one, was medical simulation. So reproducing what happens in the human body, but virtually in simulation. there were also other teams interested from the very beginning in animation, computer graphics. But then through collaboration, and that's all the idea of having an open source project, is to have collaboration. With those collaboration through international projects, for instance, there have been new topics arising. People use SOFA for biology, for gaming, and more recently for robotics, soft robotics, and control. All the philosophy of SOFA was always to build a software that was modular, efficient enough to reach interactive simulations. Independently, if you are looking at medical simulation, robotics, computer graphics simulation, anyway. So that was really the philosophy from which all started back in 2006. Now, what you will find in SOFA, and what is SOFA? It's actually a piece of codes, actually quite a lot of codes, mostly written in C++. And when you will download it, you'll download SOFA, which is under a specific license, open source, as we said before. So you can actually see and access the sources. But HGPL really means that you can download, modify the sources, improve them, and even make your own business, or make obviously your research with it, and make business with it pretty freely. So you can basically do whatever you want with SOFA. And the idea is to have always around this open source core, a community, which is improving every day the software. That's for the core of SOFA. But then on top of this core, and that's where the team of Christian Durier on soft robotics and many other teams on different topics are all arriving. Because that's a common piece of code, SOFA. And on top of this code, people are able to develop what is called plugin. Plugins, it's actually optional features, additional codes that are not inside SOFA, which are in separate repositories. And those codes, you can actually define the license you want on those codes. And that's why we have this piece of code, which is common to everyone, SOFA, and around it, you have optional features that we call the plugins. That's where research happens. That's also where some companies are developing their private codes, but the idea is always to share a common piece of code, which is the core of SOFA. So when you will make your first steps in SOFA, you can download the binaries. That's what Christian, I think, already sent you the link for downloading actually specific binaries for soft robotics. And it should work on all platforms from Windows, macOS, Linux. There is documentation coming for SOFA, and there is also a bit of documentation specific to soft robotics. You have even a website dedicated to it. And then I mentioned C++, but no worries, guys, because all the idea of what we are building is not for you to be expert in C++ codes, but we are allowing any researcher or any company in the community to not write things and simulations in C++, but to describe them using either Python or XML. Python being the most modern way of writing things. And there is a whole community around that, so you're basically never alone when starting a project. That's this idea of having an international community around SOFA. You can see here a video from guys at MIT that are actually using the work of Christian, who is a plugin for soft robotics. And they are using this plugin for building a drone, which will have a deformable gripper and that will be able to catch objects on the fly. This is possible through 15 years of development and most importantly about the development of an international community. You can see the map on the top right corner of the slide. And so that you can see a bit the profile of the community, it's still strongly influenced by research. As you can see, 80% of universities and research centers. And something that we are happy about is that more and more companies and independent developers are joining the community over the years. So a good indicator of that is that since 2006, there have been 7 companies created around SOFA on various topics. Obviously, we have a lot of things around medical simulation because it's what we are doing a lot in SOFA. And what we are also hoping in the next years is to see new applications and new commercial applications in robotics. So you can see here on the left a video from the company Insimo, where Christian is a scientific advisor. It will be a lumbar puncture. So you need to model rigid, deformable structures and all their interactions, the needle and the body of the patient. And just another video, because it's actually the video made by a company, but a company which is making developments around SOFA. So if any one of you wants to collaborate with a company for making specific developments in SOFA, you can directly contact them. That's basically the consulting company around the open source project in FinTech 3D. And to conclude about those robotics, I mean, community in robotics with SOFA, that's a short list actually, because it's I did not list all the different collaboration that occurred on the topic of soft robotics, obviously, but some of them, you can see the list of people collaborating currently in soft robotics with SOFA. So obviously, Christian will represent here INRIA and all their work around the soft robotic plugin, so which is called Soft Robots. And you have people working on catheters, for instance, at King's College London. You have people at Stanford, MIT. I mentioned the aerial work, you know, with the grasping, soft robotic grasping, University of Napoli, Bristol, and others. As I said, I did not mention them all. And I'm going to conclude with this here. We are an open source community. I'm working actually around this community to make sure that, you know, maintenance is ensured, coordination of the development is ensured, so that there is not two teams working on the same topic without collaborating, animating the community and making sure that you can make the research you are expecting with SOFA. So if you have any time, any question on SOFA, never hesitate to contact us. We are acting as third party. So we have no financial interest in any of the companies or whatever. So just contact us if you have any issue or question regarding SOFA. I just wanted to add that, you know, for your proposals and your projects for national, international projects, never hesitate to, you know, add SOFA in the project, because it's actually quite a good argument for motivating stabilization and I would say industrialization of your code even after project. It's something, the open source argument is something which is quite pretty well received by reviewers. So that's our purpose, that with SOFA you make a good research, good papers, contribution maybe to SOFA later on when you will learn SOFA, and get involved in the community and get connected to other partners. So that's for the people supporting SOFA. I'm gonna move quick on that. Again, Italian partners, Harvard partners, in FinTech 3D, as I said before, and INRIA, which is obviously the main supporter. So that's it for the open source SOFA part. As I said, never hesitate to contact us if you have any question related to SOFA. And after having this generic introduction, we'll move to the soft robotics part with the tutorial of Christian. And in the meantime, I don't know if there is already any question, but you can, I guess, ask them in the chat. I would be pleased to answer them. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Hugo. If I don't know if it's possible to directly ask questions in this.
There is a chat, so if there is questions, I'm gonna stay here for a while, so you can just ask any question you want, and I'll be available. Thank you, Christian.
So otherwise, I will start my presentation. Maybe. So I hope you see my screen. I wanted to start with our website, just to, so it's really today, it's really it's not a standard presentation, so it's more a tutorial. So I will, it will be maybe more concrete. I will speak a little bit about how we do model soft robots, but I will not present specifically any research we are conducting in the team. It's more to help you to use our tool if you want to use them and show what tools we provide to the community. So I will start with our website. So here, I think you see our website. And if you go, so it's Team Defrost at Inria. So if you go here, you will see one menu, which is software. And here, you have the link to Sofa that Hugo just presented. And you have also a link to the plugins, we are developing in the team there. So there is one plugin dedicated to soft robot and one plugin dedicated to model order reduction. I will not speak a lot about that, but it's just a method to accelerate the computation of FEM model. And then if you go down a little bit, there are other, so there is another here, another website, which present hands-on soft robotics. It's actually one of the tutorial we propose. So on this, and that I will present today. It's the fab, you, so with this you can build your own soft robot. It's the, so the design is free. The idea is a very simple soft robot, and we show the steps to model it in Sofa. Okay. Sorry, and then if you go a little bit down, there are other tutorials that are presented. And basically, today what I will show you, it's the tutorial that we prepared for the first time for the RoboSoft conference that took place in 2019. So if you go to the page of this workshop, so it was a tutorial, and that there is everything needed. Explain you what is the tutorial, etc. So you will see that the tutorial, in fact, was scheduled for one day, one full day. So there is a lot of content, and today I will just quickly go through all the content. But if you want to, of course, go deeper into the detail, you can use this page to really see in detail what we provide. So the presentation I will show you is actually given in the material. So if you go a little bit down, you will see like tutorial slides. If you click on download link, you will have the slides that I will show today. And if you go to tutorial requirements, you will see that there is a binary version of Sofa that is available. So if you go to our download page here, you click, you have this page and you can choose basically a binary version. So either you are on Linux, Windows, or on Mac, you have the three versions that are available, and you can download it. And there is the details about how to install. Okay. So that's really just concretely how we do that. So if I think. You received an email yesterday to have with a link to download the binaries. I don't know if some of you had the time to do it. I hope, but if not, you can just follow this tutorial and try it later. Basically, of course, I will not go through all the material. But you can follow the content if you want. Okay. So now you will see I will move through two things: the presentation, and I will also show you the binaries I have. So when you download the binaries, you have like this. So of course, I have several versions of Sofa on my computer. So it's a version of Sofa that is quite old. We are and it's based on Python 2.7. We are moving to Python 3, but the tutorial has not been completely adapted to Python 3. So that's why today I'm presenting with this quite old version. But it's, I mean, in the new version, the things are similar, so it doesn't change so much. So you see that in this repository, you have a repository that is called BIM, in which you have run SOFA. So you can basically, when you are, you can launch, I don't know if you see this. Maybe I will increase the size.
Okay.
If you do a bin run SOFA, normally you launch SOFA. So it's taking some time to start, but I don't know, my computer is pressed, maybe Zoom. It's a little bit of a source. Okay. It's really slow. Okay. And SOFA is sorry. I think it's really slow. I hope on your computer it's not so slow. I think it's due to the presentation. So when you start SOFA, you will have this that appears, and it's a basic animation of SOFA, and we will start with that. You will see that you can push on the button animate, and by pushing on the shift on your keyboard and clicking on the right on the left button of your mouse, you can interact directly with the object. It's an interactive simulation. It means that you can add interactively some force on the deformable model to make them move. Okay, so that's one of the big principles of SOFA, and I think that is interesting. So now let me start the presentation. Okay. So I wanted to, so you had this presentation of Hugo. I wanted to warn you that SOFA is not a commercial product, and the version we provide is, of course, a version that we did in our research team, that we are not commercial providers of products. It's more a research platform. We're trying to make it usable for other users, but of course, the idea is more to see that as something that we can develop in a community manner. It's open source, so if you want to contribute, you are more than welcome to help us in making this platform better and better. So I will present now the main principle of SOFA before showing things specific on SoftRobot. First, in SOFA, when you launch SOFA, we can see this representation that appears on the left here. It's a graph representation of what is appearing in the simulation. So in SOFA, there is a big principle is that we have different components to create a simulation, and these components are put in a graph to represent the object. Okay. Oops. Sorry, where is my presentation? I cannot switch directly. So. Okay, so this graph is a real hierarchical representation of the simulated object. The scene, so it's a graph, it's a direct asymptotic graph. It's composed of nodes, and nodes contain components, and components have features. And the data can be connected together. So, as I show you, you have the graph. So if you go deeply, so these are the nodes, and in the nodes you have components. And in the component, if you click on the component, you have the data. Okay. It's maybe a little bit difficult to switch, but if for instance here I have a different component, and if I click, I double click on the component, I have another window that appears with different data that you can see. Okay, this is working. In fact, why we do that, why we are using a graph is because we have developed a multi-level representation of objects in SOFA. For instance, imagine that I take an example with a medical simulation. It's my medical simulation, but it's also true for software. It's imagine that you have a liver inside its cavity interacting with other objects. In fact, we separate that in different parts. So there is the model, the mechanical model, which is based, for instance, here on the finite element model. But this is the liver alone. And the liver is interacting with other objects. So it needs another representation, which is the collision model. And it's also important to have a good visualization. And there is also another type of model, which is the visual part. And these three objects are in three different nodes of the graph. But of course, there is a big relationship with them. And in particular, the collision model and the visual model should follow the movement given by the deformable model. So basically, the position of this deformable model is imposed to the collision model, and it's also imposed to the visual model. In the case of the collision model, if there is a force that appears, it has to be sent back to the deformable model. So that's basically one of the principles. And then inside each node, there is different components to improve reusability. So if I take the deformable model, it's composed, in fact, into an ODO solver, a linear solver, some degrees of freedom that with the states, the position of the nodes, the velocity of the nodes, the finite element model, the external load, the mapped force, etc. And imagine that I want now to change and do a computation on GPU because I want to improve my performance. The idea is that I don't have to change everything in SOFA, I just have to change the linear solver, and maybe the way I compute my finite element model. The idea is to decompose, in fact, each model into several components to improve their reusability. So it facilitates the combination of objects with different nature, and it allows to use specific data representations such as underlying GPU. Of course, the side part of that is more difficult part is that the C++ code is quite complex, but we are trying to simplify it as much as possible these last years. Let's take an example now. So I will go back to run SOFA, and if you have installed the version that I provide you, in fact, in the repository, there is something that is called workshop, workshop PySCM, and we will open this workshop PySCM. So I do a file open, and so far, well, it's not on the. So I go back to the main main repository. And there is workshop PySCM that I can open. And when I open this, I have a browser that appears in SOFA. And it's really convenient because, in fact, you can really play with different demos. And it's really useful for those who are not used to SOFA to start. So for instance, if I click on Caduceus, the scene on Caduceus will appear, but you can click on Chain Hybrid, and there is another scene that appears that I will present now more in detail. So this chain hybrid is interesting because it shows you that we can have different type of models in SOFA, including deformable and rigid objects. So in fact, these chains, when you click on animate, it's so here, sorry, it's quite slow again on my computer, but it could be faster when you have not Zoom and in a performance computer. And what is specific here is that each of these parts, so the torus on the chain, has a different deformable model. And you can, here you see the graph, but you have another menu here, which is view. And what we see now, it's visual model, but you can have other view of the object into SOFA. You can see, for instance, the model that are used to compute the motion, the mechanics of each object. You will see that you have different representation. So now I will show you the two at the same time. So here, in fact, this torus in red is computed with FEM. This torus in green is computed with springs. This torus in yellow is computed with a method that is famous, quite famous in computer graphics, which is called FED. It's a grid, a regular grid, and you put the object into a regular grid for deformation. And this last torus is rigid, so you see only the frame of this rigid torus, which is basically the center of mass. Okay, so these are our representation. You see that for the mechanics, each object has a different representation. But when you remove that and you click on collision, you will see that all the models have the same collision model. So now I will try to explain you how it's possible. It's made possible in SOFA. Sorry. So basically, we have a component that is really important, which is a mechanical object. This mechanical object stores the state vector, the degrees of freedom. And the state vector can be of different, with different templates. So it could be a rigid with 6 degrees of freedom. It could be 1D, 2D, 3D, etc. And it's the important, it's important where you place it in the graph. So let me continue with this chain representation. I will focus on two objects, the first torus and the last one. So the first torus again is computed with FEM. So the FEM, the state of the FEM model, is given by the position of the node of the FEM. And this last one, the rigid model, the degrees of freedom are given by the gravity, the center of gravity of the object. But again, the thing is that to compute the collision between this model, you need to have a common collision model. So we will have also mechanical objects that are slaves that can basically have position and velocity, but that are imposed by a mechanical model. And this is the case of the collision model. So here the collision model and the collision model are the same. But this collision model for the first torus is driven by the FEM model, and this collision model is driven by the rigid model, so by the center of gravity. Now let's see that in SOFA. Okay, I go back to the graph. Okay, so there was the FEM, so the first torus. If I click on mechanical object here, I have, in fact, I have a problem with my, how can I see that? Okay, sorry. It's the zoom bar that makes me okay. So if I go to mechanical object, if you look at info, you see that the template of this mechanical object is Vec2D. In fact, it's normal because we are talking about a FEM model. So the position, the velocity, so the states of this mechanical object is the position of the node. Actually, I will show you. It's really that. So it's the position of the nodes that that it's given here in this mechanical object. Okay, you can have the position, the velocity of these nodes. Now, if I go to the torus, which is rigid, it's mechanical object. It's not the template, it's rigid 3D. It means it's a rigid object. In fact, it means that the position given by a vector of position plus a quaternion. So here you see that the position, it's only one frame, which has a position for the translation and a quaternion for the rotation. And of course, the velocity has a six value, okay? And basically, each of these two models, there is another node called the SURF2, okay, that is under the two, and where you have the collision model. And in that, the collision model here and here is the same. It's so if you look at that, so I have opened the two. It's a mesh, basically. It's a surface mesh that has 200 nodes, and it's what we see in the collision model. It's this mesh, okay. And the idea is that in the graph, as this mesh, in fact, is a slave of the mechanical object here, torus rigid, and this one is a slave of this mechanical object FEM. It's basically under the node here is basically a son of this node. It's a child of this one. So. Okay. Now let me go back to my presentation. Okay. So we have an important component to make this work, this app, this working correctly. It's a component called mapping. Basically, mapping, they allow to transfer the motion, position, velocity to a slave model. And the mapping also allows to transfer back to the parent some force, some collision force, for instance. So basically, here, if I take the FEM model, I have a volumetric mesh, and here I have a surface mesh for the collision. And what we will use is what we call a barycentric mapping. It's a mapping that, in fact, looks at each position of this mesh, looked where it goes into the FEM model. And as you probably know, a FEM model is based on interpolation. And as we are using linear here, linear FEM, so these are tetrahedral mesh with linear interpolation, we can use basically the barycentric coordinates. So we are looking at the barycentric coordinates of each collision node inside the FEM node. And this gives us the relationship between the position of the node and the mapped position. It's really based on a linear interpolation. So when you have the position of the nodes of your FEM, you can transfer the position to your collision node. And if you have collision on your model, you can send them back to the FEM model. You can, in fact, send back force and constraints. You can do the same with a visual model. I will show you in the graph. In fact, in the graph, you have another node which is called Visu. Basically, it's the visual model we see here. I can show it in wireframe to you. So you see that it's a mesh which is very detailed. Okay. So basically, here you have the FEM model, and basically it's the same thing. You use the interpolation of your FEM model to compute the position of your visual model. And again, the visual model is put as a child of your FEM model, of your mechanical model. Okay, I hope it was clear. I don't know if you have questions. Anyway, don't hesitate to stop me if you did. I will keep it in the chat. And probably Hugo can help you if you have some.
Yeah, I'm chatting. If you have questions about the presentation of SOFA from Christian, just unmute yourself. For technical questions, you can directly write in the chat.
Okay, and other components. So here I try to present mapping. I can quickly show you something also is the fact that for the rigid torus, of course, we are using another mapping, so which is called rigid mapping. So basically, the for the collision model, okay, that you need the wireframe. For the collision model here, we are using this rigid mapping. So basically, rigid mapping is really simple. It's just taking the position of the center of gravity and it's imposing this position of the center of gravity to all the points of this object. Okay, and basically to transmit velocity through this rigid mapping, you are using a classical Jacobian, and to transmit the force back, you are using, as you know, transpose of the Jacobian. Okay. And for the visualization, you have another barycentric. You have another rigid mapping, which is here. It's for this visual model. Okay. For this visual model, we are using again a rigid mapping. Okay. Now another thing that is important is the solver. So in the solver, we have time integration. We can use implicit or explicit integration. Then we have a linear solver. Basically, when you compute implicit, you come up usually with a non-linear system to solve. And what we are using is a Newton iteration to solve this implicit. In practice, to make it real time, we are often using only one step of the Newton algorithm. But now you have some algorithm available in SOFA to make several steps of Newton, if it's necessary. And basically, these are based on visitor that will go through the graph and basically ask your information about all components. I will not go into detail because this is more software related, but just what is important is that you can have two configurations. If I take this example, I can have two configurations. If I put my solver basically directly on the node of my object, it means that my solver will directly solve the equation of what is under the graph here. So I can have two independent solvers, one for my rigid object, one for my FEM model. So in that case, the size of the solver is 3n because I have three equations per node on my FEM. If I put a solver directly on my rigid object, I will have a solver of size 6. Because I have six equations for my rigid object. Okay. If I decide to put a node with a solver and put my other objects under this node, then the solver will be automatically 3n+6. So it will basically put in the same solver the DFEM plus the WGDEV. Okay. Just this is something to know, the fact how you can play with that. Sometimes it's important, depending on what you want to do, to have the two objects in the same server or not, depending on the coupling you want between the objects. Then another component that is important in Solfa is force field. Basically, to give all these different behavior to the different tourists, you can use different type of force field. So for the FEM, we use tetrahedron FEM force field. For the FFD, there is a regular grid spring force field. For the spring model, we use a mesh spring force field. So, and you have tons of force field in SOFA for different type of model, of different model. Okay.
Christian, there was a question related to that. Asked, sorry, by Donatella, who was asking, you know, how to set geometries and to set materials. So since you are talking about mechanical laws and how things deform.
A little bit. So for the, actually I will present that now. For the geometry, you have to load the mesh. So basically, when I go back to SOFA, when I load geometry, in fact, here I have used, so you have, of course, a lot of type of measure. So here we have used a GMSH, and we have developed a specific loader for GMSH mesh. Okay, so basically, in the repository of your scene, SOFA scene, you can put a file with your mesh, and you can load it to a loader. And there is a component which is called mesh topology that in fact use this the basically it look at what is given in the loader in terms of position, edge, and triangles here, and of course tetra to assign the topology, okay, and the geometry. And the other question is how to assign material. Yeah? And to assign material, it's more related to how we compute force and how it's compute force. We for instance, in tetrahedron FEM force field, we can assign a Young modulus. You can basically assign one Young modulus for all your mesh. Or you can also put a list of Young modulus that this, if this list corresponds to the list of elements you have in your mesh, it will assign a different Young modulus for each element. Okay. So the topology is important because it will give the geometry and where is the points and the connectivity between the two points. So you have edge, triangles, quad, tetrahedron, hexagon, whatever, and so on. And we can even create mapping between the topology, but I will not go into the detail. There are also some people that are working more and more into the fact that we can do directly in SOFA the meshing. So there is a plugin which is called Seagal. That relies on another open source software which is called SIGA that it is developed at INRIA that allows to do a mesh, particularly tetrahedral mesh. And there is another approach which is based on Python, and basically you import GMSH library and you can use the Python to ask GMSH to do your mesh. In a Python, when you create your scene in Python. So of course I could say a lot about that, but the time is quite short today, so I will not go into too much detail. How much time left remains? It's
40 minutes.
40 minutes. Okay. So the because I would like to talk a little bit about software at some point, but anyway, so there is that it's important these things to explain you how to the basics of SOFA. One of the basic things of SOFA is of course collision models, is the representation of the mesh I showed you previously. Here I show you triangle mesh. So triangle mesh are composed of triangle, point, and line. And there is also a sphere that are basics components. And oriented building blocks, in fact, this I didn't show you, but when you look at the collision model, so I will remove the visual model. In fact, this to accelerate the collision between model, this collision model are bounded with boxes. And in the pipeline of collision of SOFA, the basically instead of computing collision between all triangles of this mesh, with all triangles of this mesh, we have developed acceleration. This is really standard. But this acceleration to really find where is the point of interaction. Here we can see the fact that we compute the interaction between the two. It's based on proximity here in that case. And we to accelerate the finding of this, basically we put the mesh into a hierarchical building box, and the computation is accelerated with this algorithm. This is a really standard in computer graphics. Let me continue. In fact, there is three steps in the collision. There is the birth phase. We are first computing interaction between building blocks to accelerate the computation. When we found where is the collision more closely, we are computing narrow phase. It's really computation of interaction between primitives, and then we provide a response. Okay, you have different algorithms, and in terms of response, you have either penalty methods. Penalty, basically the idea is to put springs where you have collision, and Lagrange multiplier. It's another technique that are based on Lagrange multiplier and that provides more accurate response. So now I will go through more detail into the tutorial. So the idea of this tutorial, this specific tutorial about the tripod, is to give you an example of a soft robot that is implemented, that is simulated and controlled in SOFA. The idea is to see how we model the deformation with FEM, how we model the actuators, how we model the connection between actuators and FEM, and how we model collision and use inverse simulation. I think I will skip model collision and just show you really rapidly the different steps. So if I go back in SOFA, if you still have your browser open, there is in fact different scenes that are proposed, and this tripod tutorial, when you click on it, so you see that your browser changed, and you really have a detailed plugin, and that's why I think I can go fast here today, because every steps is really detailed. So if you want to redo it at home, you can really do it. I just explain you how it works. Basically, you can use try the scene in SOFA, okay, and the scenes appears in your SOFA, and then you can basically see also how the scene. So to create this scene, we in fact we are using a Python code, and the Python code is explained in detail when you look at show hide the code. I just realized that on this version of SOFA, there is a bug for macOS only. So you should not have this bug in your version if you are using Windows. And if you are using Linux, but there is a problem with the OGL frame that is here. And when there is an OGL frame, there is this better visualization. So I will go back to another version that has been corrected. And if you need this, if you are in macOS, just send me an email. I will explain you how to correct it in your binaries. So I remember that I have another version of this. So this was not. You can launch also your thing like I do. So I started on the tripod tutorial. Okay, and when I and you click on again, when you click on try the scene, okay, this is better. So you can basically see step by step. So basically, this tutorial has been done to model again this robot, and it's really starting from the beginning. So how we can basically build a mechanical model. So we'll start from that. Basically you have all the points that have no mechanical object on them, but just a mass under gravity. And then in step two, you see, how we can create now a FEM model. So you, but the FEM model is, is free to move in under gravity. And then you can add constraints. So you see how to add constraints. So how to put a box basically and fix some node into SOFA. And it comes to what is more interesting and maybe specific to what we do in the plugin SoftRobot, which is adding actuator and connecting deformable part. So first, I will explain you how we model actuators in SOFA. To model the soft robot, we are using FEM nonlinear models. So it could be a really different type of soft robots. So today I show you more parallel-like robots. Here in this example, it's more like a trunk with cables, but the main principle doesn't change. The idea is that when you compute the force in the FEM model, the FEM provides you basically the mass and the internal force, which is more important, I would say, is the internal force. The mass is important if you want to have a dynamic model, but you could start with a quasi-static model, so which you can consider that we neglect this part. Okay. What is important is that in fact to deform create real soft robots, we will add some force that comes from our actuators. And for that, we use Lagrange multiplier, which have this form, HT and lambda. Okay, so HT gives, in fact, the direction of the force, inside the FEM model, and which node is impacted directly by the actuator. And lambda is the intensity of the force. Okay. And another part which is important is that the FEM model provides you internal force, but this internal force are usually non-linear. So to do a computation, we have to do a linearization. It's basically the principle of a Newton algorithm. So we are using linearization of this internal force. Okay. And if I go to the following steps, in fact, it goes fast. So I think there was a step in between. Sorry for that. Let's see. I have this equation here. So basically, I imagine that I use a quasi-static model. Maybe it's easier. So if I use a quasi-static model, I also neglect in my internal force the force that I use to velocity. So the there is no
damping.
Damping. Thank you, Hugo. There is no damping. So the linearization here is only when I do a step in position, I only the internal force that coming from the previous steps, and this stiffness matrix that corresponds to basically the linearization of this internal force in my current position. And of course, this linearization has to change at every steps of my computation. Okay, so I have this linearization that comes on this part, and my initial force that comes here. Basically, I will look at the difference between my external force, like the gravity force, for instance, and my my internal force. It will give me a vector B that I know. I know also this matrix A, which is usually, so it's always matrix that is symmetric to be definite. As we are doing a quasi-static computation, you have to fix some nodes, otherwise this matrix is not definite. So when you fix some node, it becomes definite. And here it's a vector of which is your unknown, which are the motion of your nodes. And imagine that you have a robot that is made with cables. So basically, HT represents the direction of the force that the cables apply on your FEM model. So imagine that I have a cable like that in through my FEM model. So of course, it's a little bit caricatural here, but it was more to make it really clear. So when I will put a force, basically a pulling force on my cable, I will have basically a force that will be applied here on my node here where I have fixed my cable, but I will also have some force that are applied on nodes where there is an inflection of my cable. And basically in HT, I just feel a vector. So it's basic. You can see if you have only one cable, HT basically is just a vector. It's a matrix of one column, if you want. And with where there is zero everywhere, except on the nodes which are impacted by the cable. And in that node, the value you have is the direction of this vector. Okay. So it's how we compute cables in our format. If you have, if you instead you are not using cable, if you are using, for instance, pneumatic, in that case, HT represents the direction of the, so it will be a value for all the nodes that are around the cavity, and the direction will be given by the pressure around this cavity. And so here in the cable case, lambda is the pulling force, and in the pressure case, lambda would be the pressure inside the cavity. Anyway, so just to explain you how it works. So imagine that you have a cable. Then you can either impose a force or impose a length on this cable. And it's not the same thing. If you impose a force, it's quite easy. It's quite direct. Basically, you just have to say, okay, I impose my force on lambda. And basically, this value, it's a known value. And you just have basically to add this to the known value to the B vector, and you can compute. Okay. If you are imposing length, that's absolutely not the same story, because first you have to be careful that you can only pull on a cable you cannot push. So lambda, you don't know the value of lambda. You impose the displacement of your cable, but if you don't know the value of lambda, it means that you have to make sure that this lambda stays always positive, if you consider that it's positive when you pull. But in addition to that, you have to make sure that it only provides a positive value if the cable is tightened. Okay? If the cable is loose, there is no possible force. Okay, and in that case, lambda should be zero. So it can be written like that. Basically, this comes to zero if the cable is tightened. Here it's the initial length of the cable. and basically, if this is zero, this can be positive. And if this is here negative, strictly negative, it means that this is zero. And so we call that a complementarity between the two. So one is zero and this is strictly negative, or this is zero and this is strictly positive. And so it means that to solve that, it's a little bit more complex. You need to have an optimization and find a solver that is able to solve this system. To do that, is that we are solving, we are using a solver that projects the equation in the constraint space. And this is really, really interesting to do that. And I try to convince you for that. So basically, you take the matrix A here, you take this, the inverse, and you project it into the constraint space that we have defined with our Lagrange multiplier. In fact, if you have several actuators, you can have several columns in the matrix H, and basically you can basically compute all the equations in the constraint space. Okay. But moreover, we can also add constraints, so we can have multiple constraints for cable, but we could also add constraints for the effector, for instance. Okay. And in that case, it's the same thing. It's just that we select one point in our FEM model. And basically, we will define a column vector here for the effector that is zero everywhere except for the node here, where basically we will have identity map. Three by three, you know, identity matrix. So, for instance, if I have three positions of my N effector, I will have three columns dedicated to in my matrix H T for the effector, and at the corresponding location of this node, I will have an identity matrix. Okay. And if you do that, if you do this computation, you have something that is really, really cool, which is basically the compliance matrix in the constraint space. I try to explain you what it is. It means that if you look carefully at what we have here we have lambda, which is the force I have in my cable. Okay, and I have selected here in my matrix H the columns that corresponds to my cable. So I have here on this robot, imagine that I have eight cable. Okay, I have eight columns, eight value for my cables. And if I put a force on one of these cable, I put it through H, I compute A minus one, and then I have basically the motion created by this lambda, for by this force that I have put on my cable. And when I use H, in fact, I have projected this motion into my end effector space. So I have the motion of the end effector. So it means that through this relationship, I can have directly the link between the force I apply on the cable and the motion it creates on my end effector. And the good thing is that if I have, for instance, three directions for my end effector and eight directions for my cables, here my matrix, the size of my matrix is 3 by 8. Okay, so it's a small matrix compared to my A matrix, which is very potentially very big, which corresponds to the size of my model multiplied by 3. So for instance, if I have 200 nodes on my FEM, it will be the dimension of A matrix is 600. And 600 is not very big for FEM model. You can have, if you have one precision, probably you will use mesh with thousands of nodes. Okay, but in fact, this approach allows to be independent from the size of A minus one. And of course, when we do here, I put A minus one, but in practice, we never compute completely A minus one. We are using a factorization of this matrix, not the computation of the full inverse. Anyway, so when I have W EG, you see that this applies for, of course, the relationship between cable and effector. So it's what we write here with EA. Okay. And when I have a variation of my lambda actuator, I can compute the variation of position of my effector. But I can also do it for my cables. So it means that I will put here and here the same matrix. And when I will, in that case, I have the compliance in the constraint space of the actuator. So when I pull on one actuator, I know the displacement in the space of my actuator. Okay. And basically, when you have the, so it gives you this second equation. And when you have the two equations here, basically you can compute the Jacobian of your robot, of your soft robot. In fact, you just have to inverse this equation. And it basically gives you the relationships between the displacement of your actuator and the force it creates. Okay. And basically, you apply this force to this equation and you obtain this equation. And it's really important. I put it in a blue box here because for me, it's one of the thing that is really nice in this modeling is the fact that you can compute exactly the same thing as a Jacobian for a jig robot, but using the compliance of your robot. So here you really take into account the parameter of your materials. And it allows to give you an equivalent of the Jacobian, because I have for a displacement that I create, a small displacement that I create on my actuators, through the Jacobian, I have the displacement of my effector. And it's really takes into account the mechanics. It's really generic. So we can do that, but we can also compute the inverse. And in that case, it's more an optimization problem. Basically, in that case, you have basically the displacement of your end effector that you want to drive. So I want to minimize the end effector displacement here. In that case, I want to know how much force I need to put on my cable to have this displacement. And it's, if you write again the equations, you minimize the position of your effector compared to a reference position. So you have a quadratic minimization under some constraints. So some constraints are, for instance, I cannot push on my cable, I can only pull. So this depends, of course, on the type of your actuators, but here we have cables and it's the case. And if you can also put some other constraints that are the course of your actuators. So because usually if you have a motor, you cannot indefinitely pull on your cables. And this is a quadratic programming algorithm. It's really classical. And you have many solvers that can compute this type of equations. The only problem I have on this specific robot is the fact that I have more actuators than effectors. So it means that I have not a well-defined problem. I have several solutions to my problem, to my inverse problem. So to have a unique solution, in fact, I will add one thing in my minimization, which is the minimization of the deformation energy. And the minimization of the deformation energy is related to the mechanical work of the actuators and can be computed through this value. Oops. Okay. And in fact, this value can be added to the minimization with a small, so there is an epsilon then that you have to tune. basically, that will help to have a well-defined problem. In fact, the matrix here is definite, while this matrix here is not fully definite. But as you will add the two matrix, the matrix of the minimization will become then definite. So to tune this parameter, we have defined something, way of computing that works usually in many cases it's working fine, but of course. For those who have worked on minimization problem, you know that when you have multiple criteria on minimization, it's always a problem of also playing with this weight. And in that case, you can compute again. It's a quadratic program. I will not give that you. It follows the KKT conditions that are well known. It's another story, but basically you can compute the inverse problem of your robot. Basically you drive the displacement of your effector, and thanks to that it gives you how to pull on the cables to follow the displacement. And this is completely open loop. So you see also the precision we can have, and something that is really soft thanks to the FEM formulation. So we benefit from the two. We benefit from the fact that we have FEM model. So we have a mechanical model that really takes into account the complexity of the deformations. But we also have this minimization with a small matrix system thanks to the condensation in the constraint space that allows to do this optimization in real time. Now I will have to go fast because I spent a lot of time on that. Okay, oops. So for the tutorial, we use exactly the same approach. I don't know how much time is still. 10 minutes? Like that?
Just 10 minutes.
Yeah.
Okay. Just I go fast. If you want to redo the tutorial, you will see that you have actuators are not cables in that case, but are direct servo motors. Okay. We have defined some what we call prefab. It's a small Python code to model these motors. We have on top of that we have rigid links. And in fact, we are able to make links between the deformable part and this rigid component. So the servo motors is an articulated rigid system, and the FEM model is of course a deformable model. And basically, so this I will skip because you can do it by yourself. The only part which is a little bit tricky to understand, so I will use my 5 minutes to explain you that, is how we link the rigid part and the deformable part. Basically, it's the idea is that when you have a deformable model, you have a lot of nodes. And if you want to rigidify some parts, in fact, you have to take some nodes in the FEM and consider that these nodes are rigid. And in fact, we will use the mapping in SOFA to do that. Basically, I explain you that with a rigid frame, you can define some slave nodes that basically are driven by this rigid frame. And basically, here in the specific thing we do is that we will separate the nodes of the FEM that are slaves and the nodes that are free to move, that are remaining FEM nodes. And basically, what we will do is that we will do a mapping that takes the remaining nodes and the slaves nodes here to create another node that is basically under these two, which is also a slave, basically that do the FEM computation of the model. And thanks to that, so it's really using the concept of mapping in SOFA, except that in that case, it's a multi-mapping, so it's a slave model, but basically the computation of this model is coming from two models, one model here and one model. And it's also the occasion to tell you that the rigid mode, basically this concept of mapping can be done in cascade in SOFA. So you can have a slave node that drive another slave node. It's not a problem, but just you have to have this logic to have a correct computation. Okay. And it's what we do. And thanks to the concept of mapping, when we compute the FEM model here, we can push the force so on this direction. So you go down, you transmit velocity and position. And on the other side, you can put back the internal force, the force. Okay, and in practice, you have to put your solver at the top. So the degrees of freedom of your system is the remaining node of your FEM plus the rigid frame. Okay, so if there is n remaining nodes plus one rigid frame, you have a system of 3n plus 6 equations. And in fact, if you look at the stiffness matrix of your FEM, in fact, you use Jacobian. So it's really classical for people that are that knows a little bit about Jacobian in robotics. So G is the Jacobian of the rigid mapping, okay? And basically, we will use the Jacobian here to transmit displacement in the so displacement of the rigid frame into the space of the nodes that are slaves, and basically to transmit force that are applied on this slave node to the rigid frame, we will use the GT. The transpose of the Jacobian. So at the end, you have a system that's computing like that and allows to do that. So that's why we can have basically a rigid part and have like this type of modeling. So maybe I will show you directly on SOFA. So it will explain you how to add actuators. This thing, and then it will explain how to rigidify the parts of SOFA. So we will have if I try the thing in SOFA, I have the part that are now rigidified. You see that it's driven by a rigid object here. Okay, so it's really slow. Okay, and then again, it's really explained. Then we can attach this rigid part to the servo motors, okay, and we can add controller to basically because in fact the robot is built with a flat deformable sheet and then put in place, so you can reproduce that thanks to controller. So if you want to play with that, you can go to the scene. Here, the money, if you have the servo motors, I will remove that because otherwise it's really, really slow in my computer. And basically, if I put a control A, I have the animation where basically to place the servo motors correctly. So here I have the servo motors that are placed correctly. And then you can play with, I think it's with the arrow. You can play with the robot as if you have it in front of you. So you can reproduce the motion of the robot on your actuators. But here is still a direct simulation. Okay, here I drive, in fact, I drive the motion of my directly of my actuators. So you can skip the collision. You can also, there is a thing, a step of connecting with the physical robot, but I go to the step 8, where you can inverse the system. Basically, in fact, in that case, we have in the top, you have the QP solver that solve the system. So the system, the small system I tried to show you. So with the inverse problem, so it's an optimization, quadratic optimization. So in that case, you have to first do control A to put the actuator in place. And when they are in place, you can press control I, and then you have basically the opportunity to directly drive the effector of the robot. So for instance, if I move the effector, it computes how to move the motors. I can also so I can decide to move it here. So it follows the position here of this node. Yep. And it computes how to move the motors to the right position. Okay. And basically you in the QP inverse solver, you have the epsilon value that I showed you to also make it more stable if the prime is like have multiple solutions. That's it for this small tutorial. Again, it's more an overview. If you go to the if you follow this workshop, you will have much more details. For instance, you can click on the trunk, which is exactly the example that I show you in the video. You have another robot which allows to have an inverse problem with a friction contact. So you can play with a rolling robot. I'm not sure how it works. This scene. I think I can click on this, but it doesn't help me to click. Normally you have to drive this little point. I don't know exactly. You can also play with model order reduction, particularly. So it's a method that is used to have a fast computation. You probably know this robot. If you try to reproduce it in FEM with a fully FEM model, it will never be real time. Here we provide a real time version thanks to the model order reduction. It's another plugin in Sofa. And if you press basically on control plus, you can inflate the cavity in real time. If I want to inflate another cavity, I have to press first, for instance, control one, and I will inflate another cavity. Control two, I inflate another cavity, et cetera, et cetera. Okay. And if you press zero, you go back to the other cavity, and then you can press control minus, and you can deflate the cavity. Okay. So again, when you do that, then you can go back to here. Okay, I should maybe stop the animation first because so far it's dying, and then yes, you have okay. So then just is to say that you in this workshop you have other scene. You can also, if you are interested for a song for Gripper, there's a scene also dedicated to Gripper. There is maybe a scene more dedicated to Contact, etc., etc. That's it for me. again, it was more an overview than really a tutorial. I hope you will have the opportunity to test this, and you understood a little bit of the method. I tried to explain more, maybe more the inverse model, to because it's maybe one of the originality of the work. Is there thank any you. Question?
Thank you very much, Christian.
You're welcome.
And thank you, Hugo. I've seen that there were a lot of questions during your talk, and Hugo was replying to all the
questions. Okay, great. That's a good way of sharing the work.
Yes. I don't know if there are other questions or curiosity.
There was a last question.
In the chat, I got many again technical questions. If you have more generic questions, like, you know, would you be able to model and control that or that robot, or if you have any questions of what is possible or not, don't hesitate to ask.
So there is a forum. So also maybe some of your questions also have been answered in the forum, so don't hesitate to look at the forum. And the forum is, so Hugo is making a really nice job in trying to answer all the questions in the forum, but I think what I would like in the future is something more community-like. So if there is a question you had at some point and you solved that, and you see that a person in the forum has the same question and you have the answer, don't hesitate to answer yourself also. It's really what I would like to have is a community, because of course for us it's complex to answer all the questions, and it's better if this is shared in a community.
I've seen that there is a question from Christian Tamantini.
Yes, can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, so thank you for the overview about the SOFA software. I have just a curiosity about the results of the software, because you've shown us how can we visualize the results, but it is possible to export some files, some results about the simulations.
Yes, so of course it was short, so I didn't give all the details. So basically, when you create your scene in SOFA, you use Python code, okay? For instance, so if you go into the details, you will see that the command, for instance, when I inflate cavities or when I pull on tables or when I move the motors, these are, we use the concept of controllers in SOFA, and these controllers are written in Python. And basically, the idea is that in Python, you have access to all the data that is available in SOFA. You see, so when I clicked, you know, on the windows of SOFA, I showed you a component, and in this component, you had position, velocity, and many, many, many other data. Okay. Basically, in Python, you have access to all these data. And then basically you can create your controller that put in what file you want, in what format you want, that export the value you want in your preferred format. It's just that you have to write probably a small Python code. For very, very usual case, there are already existing Python files that that provides you that. For instance, you can export meshes easily. So for instance, if you want, you have done a simulation and you want to export the different meshes at different positions, it's possible. It's already natively possible. But for me, what I suggest is to create the Python code. It's not complex to code in Python, and you don't have to. It's convenient to because you have access to all the value, all data into so far. Another thing is that I skip it also, but in the tutorial, so if you want to basically plug your SOFA with your robot and do a direct connection, it's also possible. And there is, of course, the example that is provided in the tutorial, where because I skip it, but there is a step where we directly connect the robot with SOFA. We have developing also tools to connect sensors to SOFA. So if you want to do closed loop, so you can connect your sensor and have the value of your sensor connected in SOFA, and it allows to adapt the model in SOFA to have a model in SOFA in real time that is closer to your real robot. And so then you can do a closed loop. I skip it also, but there is possibility also to do that.
Thank you so much. Amazing, this software.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you again. There is a comment in the chat from Eben Eretz. It's a great presentation. It will be much appreciated if you are able to share more demonstration or examples in videos and share the link to your email.
Yeah, okay. okay. Video, examples in video. I think, I have a recorded version of this tutorial. I think it's a version of the tutorial where it's a little bit longer, so I can show it. There was also, I think Hugo, there was also, if you have, there are also shared video in the consortium website, right, Hugo?
Yes, I'm gonna send the link we have a Twitter, LinkedIn, YouTube account. On YouTube, I'm gonna send you the link. We have videos, not only on soft robotics, but I'm gonna send you, we made a specific playlist on YouTube only on soft robotics simulations. So I'm gonna send it in a few seconds.
But I agree with you, I will, and probably it's a message for the team. I think we should more record the tutorial version and put more tutorial in our YouTube account. I will try to motivate people here to do to do more tutorial. Okay.
But if you have some additional information that you want to share with the participants, you can send all the information to Matteo Magazzino, and okay, he will send an email to all the participants and with your materials.
Yeah, you can also just you can just also have a look at our YouTube account. So there is a YouTube account for the team Defrost, and there's a YouTube account for the consortium so far for video. And look also at the website, and yeah, we are trying to maintain it as much as we can. Okay. Thank you very much for inviting me. It was a pleasure to present you. I hope that also we could do another tutorial face-to-face in a future RoboSoft conference.
Yes, I hope very soon.
Yeah.
Thank you again. It was a very inspiring talk.
Thank you.
Thank you. And now it's time to start with the group activity. So thank you again, Ugo. Thank you, Christian. Goodbye.
Bye-bye.
And I leave the floor to Matteo Magazzini.